see. Okay. My name is Bob Schraber. I am a clinical audiologist with East Valley Hearing Center. I'm the director of audiology for East Valley. And our practice has been established for about 30 years. This past month, we've been in the Valley for 30 years.
And I've been saying his name wrong. It's Dr. Schraber. And I got stuck on that.
That's okay. I've been called a lot of things. So it's Schraber, Schraber. It tends to get destroyed. Thank you.
Well, we'll see if we can undestroy it. But have you already introduced yourself and how Dr. Schraber came by desiring to do this? So we really appreciate him coming today and sharing with us. So you four will get it from the horse's mouth. And so you have to be experts out there in the field on managing hearing aids. And I can tell you that you're going to see a lot of them because I am going in that direction. So I'll be in assisted living probably soon.
There you go.
So.
There you go. And I'm really pleased that Jim invited me. I really jumped at the opportunity to chat with you because as an audiologist, I've been into many assisted living centers. And unfortunately, a lot of our own patients that we have fit with hearing aids, we find once they get into an assisted living center, they stop hearing aid. A lot of the staff are unfamiliar with the hearing aid. Patients are walking around with hearing aids on. As many of you know, a lot of our senior citizens, when they reach a certain age, their personal hygiene tends to decline, and as a result, they don't take care of their hearing aids very well. So just for me to have the opportunity to show you a few things that I think will help not only the patient, but help in your interactions with those patients, I think that's huge. I've done a lot of in-services in nursing homes and assisted living centers, and unfortunately the turnover is such that I can come back 6 months later and half the people I just trained are no longer there. They've moved into other areas. So again, just the opportunity to chat with you, I think hopefully I can give you some basic information to take home and help you in your jobs. What I'd like to do first is talk to you a little bit about the hearing process. Can you see that pretty well? Okay. Right now, when we talk about the process of hearing, we're talking about sound which actually travels down the ear canal and goes through the eardrum and then a series of little middle ear bones. You might remember them from school, the hammer, the anvil, and the sickle. They're the smallest human bones in the human body. That comprises the middle ear system. And then from there, it goes into that little snail shell apparatus called the cochlea. That's the inner ear nerve. Sensory neural hearing loss is what we classify that if there's any damage to those hair cells. And then it goes up the auditory nerve for processing higher up in the brain. Right now in the United States, about 90 to 94% of the hearing losses that are diagnosed are in the inner ear and the cochlea. And that's important because when we diagnose a hearing loss like that, that is a permanent disability. And I want to go into the cochlea and you'll see these little hair cells here. Okay. Those hair cells, this cochlea is actually filled with fluid. And as the sound travels through the cochlea, it literally strikes those hair cells and moves them back and forth. So let me see if we can come back out. I'm going to go into a different part of this because I want to show you what happens when those hair cells are damaged. That's actually permanent. And when we recommend hearing aids, we're not always doing our patients a great job because we're not correcting their hearing. Even though a lot of the hearing aid ads will tell you that. So again, if we look at that hair cell in the inner ear in the cochlea, okay, when those hair cells are damaged, that's permanent. When we look at eye care, if you're nearsighted or farsighted, if you get the right prescription with your glasses, your vision is corrected to 20/20. We do not have that with sensory neural hearing loss. What's happening is we're stimulating the nerves back there that are still viable along with the damaged nerves. And those damaged nerves will never function like a normal hearing nerve. So we really don't have a 20/20 correction when it comes to fitting patients with hearing aids. As a result, when you talk to someone who wears a hearing aid, probably the first thing they'll do is tell you their list of complaints. My hearing aid makes things too loud, things are too sharp. Where I really need it is in a group where there's a lot of background noise. I can't hear very well in background noise with my hearing aids. And that goes back to the fact that we're dealing with a damaged neural system. So it's important to understand that. And when we finish today, one of the things I would like to do is just talk briefly about when you go into someone's room, someone's apartment, and you're dealing with them for assistive care, there are some things that you can do that will help improve the communication. Number one, keep in mind, if they're wearing hearing aids, their hearing is not normal. Okay, so hopefully that's one of your takeaways from today. Talk to you a little bit about hearing aids, and there are different types and styles of hearing aids. Where do we go here? I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with the different types. I can pass them around. This one here is called a completely in the canal style. If you want to pass that around. Very, very tiny hearing aid. A lot of people want that because they don't want anyone to know they're wearing a hearing aid. And it amazes me, someone who's 75 or 80 years of age, they're still into the cosmetics. I don't want to wear something big or bulky. Everyone's going to think I'm deaf. They want something very small. And that's a real problem because it goes down deep in the ear canal where the wax glands are, and they tend to get plugged up a lot. So very much like a contact lens for the eye, those small hearing aids are more maintenance. And again, as someone gets older, they may know how to get it in their ear, but they're not always taking care of it and cleaning the little openings as well as they should. So it's important to keep that in mind. Next style up from that is the in the canal, and a little bit larger, a little bit larger battery. Sometimes there's controls on it, like a volume control or a program button, so that they can be adjusted. Each one of these have pros and cons to them. This is an in-the-ear style, larger still. Typically for our senior citizens, the larger the hearing aid, the better, because it's something that they can typically handle. A lot of our seniors have neuropathies. They lose sensitivity in their fingertips. They have a hard time getting some of these instruments in. If they don't get the instrument in correctly, they're not going to hear as well as they could or should. They have a problem changing the batteries if the batteries are very tiny. So we tend to want to recommend something that the patient can handle. This one here is a behind the ear type instrument. And it has a little tube that comes down with an earpiece that goes in the ear. And then we also have a more traditional one. That's not really quite the same thing. Traditional behind the ear type. Bigger, bulkier, but patients can handle those larger instruments a lot better than something that's very, very tiny.
I got a question. On the bigger ones, you can see by the way it's conformed how it would fit inside the ear, but some of these smaller ones, I'm looking at it, it's got a little irregularity to it, but I am not seeing automatically.
I agree. You can
get
it in up. Well, there is a right side up, and that's a problem with the smaller ones, because once you get down in the ear canal, a hearing aid made for the right ear could almost fit the left ear if they put it in upside down. So what we try to do is color code it. Usually the right one is red, left one is blue, or now they have them that are painted all black, and then they put a big R or a big L on it for right or left. But even still, those instruments have to go into the ear canal a certain way in order to fit well. So you have a patient with poor dexterity, the hearing aid started, but they don't get it in all the way. They're not going to hear very well. It's going to irritate the ear. Just a lot of issues. So it's important to keep that in mind.
Do you recommend any lubrication?
We tend to use it in our office with new fits, kind of like getting a pair of new shoes. The first time you get a hearing aid, it fits kind of snug. So we will use a little bit of a lubricant on there so it slides in and out. We'll go over with the patient how to take it off, how to put it on. Once we get away from that after a few weeks of in trial, we try to avoid the lubricants, because what happens with our seniors is they start glopping it on, it builds up, it plugs up the microphone or the speaker, and then the hearing aid won't work, then they're upset and they have to come back in the office. So lubricants have a place, but we try to not use that too often.
Question?
Yep.
Can you give us an idea of about the price difference between these different? Because obviously I think that the smaller is the more expensive.
Not necessarily. Yeah, that's a good question. I can go through that. The issue is it's going to depend on what you get and where you go. You can go to Costco and you can get hearing aids that start at about $500 and go up to about $1,500. There are some places out in East Mesa where they make their own hearing aids in the back and they put on a shell, and they start at about $300 and go up to $800 or $900 a piece. Our practice tends towards full digital devices that are more high-end, so our prices start at around $1,200 and go up to about $3,500 a piece. So it depends on not the style, because it used to be the style of the hearing aid dictated the cost. The smaller the hearing aid, the more expensive. Now you can get all those different styles in a very basic digital technology. You can get it with something that's got 20 channels and all sorts of noise reduction capacity, multiple programs, so you can get really sophisticated. Some of them now are Bluetooth, where if you have a Bluetooth device, you can pair it to your cell phone, to your computer. Yeah, they're really getting quite sophisticated. Okay, so when we talk about the different hearing aids, to me, one of the important takeaways is that a hearing aid consists of three basic elements: a microphone to pick up the sound, an amplifier inside to make the sound louder, and then a speaker to turn that sound back into something our ears can hear and understand. So when you look at the different hearing aids, what you want to basically look at is where those three elements are. And I would tell you, use, if you can help the patient, use a toothbrush to clean the hearing aid. Just a basic, cheap, old 20-cent toothbrush will do well. So let me, for instance, show you, and I can pull those out of the ears, but this here is a canal style instrument. On the outside here is a little hole, that's where the microphone is to pick up the sound. And then inside is the amplifier, and then at the other end are two holes. One of them is where the speaker presents the sound to the eardrum. The other hole is an air vent that typically goes through, and that's so that your ears don't feel like you have a plug or a cork in them. No circuitry in that hole, it just lets air in and out, so it's a more comfortable fit. If you have a patient who they're wearing hearing aids and you know that they're not hearing you well, it could be a number of reasons. Probably first and foremost is the battery's dead. Check the battery, and I'll show you how to do that. Ask the patient. Typically, they'll have a pretty good supply of batteries. The other issue is that there's either wax or debris plugging up the microphone or the speaker. So typically, when they come in our office and they come in, we're going to bring the hearing aid in the lab and literally just brush the openings. You don't have to do anything about going in. You want to just kind of tip it down and just brush the opening. Now, we have other fancier tools for that. There's one here with a little wire loop on it, and if there were debris down in, you could go in and clean that out. My feeling is for where you're at, just use a toothbrush, just something gross to kind of clean both ends of it. If you do that and you change the battery, I would tell you probably 3 out of 4 times the hearing aid's going to work. Our patients a lot of times will forget. Should I stop moving around? Okay. A lot of times our patients forget to change their batteries. Most of the new hearing aids will warn you. One company's hearing aid will tell you low battery in your ear. Another one will tell you beep, 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 beep every 10 or 15 minutes, and that's the indication the battery is getting ready to quit. A lot of our patients don't pay attention to that as they get older. So it's important that you check the battery and make sure that there's not a problem with that.
As regards a speaker, is there like a little device or a little plug that goes in that can be removed?
Yeah, some of the wax. Yeah, let's take a look at the, where's the models? Let me see if I can kind of show you. Okay. And again, on the back of your handout there are some links to YouTube instructions on how to clean hearing aids that will go into some detail. What you're talking about is this is what's called a receiver in the canal. The electronics are primarily back here, but there's a little wire in there, and then it goes to the speaker. And that speaker is what presents the sound to the ear. There's a little flexible dome on here, and that's to center the speaker in the middle of the ear canal and to keep it in place so it's not moving back and forth or popping out. You can actually pull that little dome off, and there's a little white tip in there, and that is just a wax guard. It's designed to prevent wax from getting in and plugging up the receiver or the speaker. Typically, the patient should have a little kit with batteries, some cleaning tools, and usually they will have replacement tips. Now, I don't know how comfortable you feel changing these, but if you can just take the dome off, there's a replacement tip on one side and an empty post on the other. And you simply put the empty post in, pull it out, and then put a new one in, and you're good to go. It's not real hard to do. If you're comfortable to do it, a lot of our patients will say their eyes are just not good enough to see something that small. So that's one type of device that takes what we call a wax guard.
And those things, can you purchase those at Walmart?
No, you typically are going to get those from the hearing aid place that you bought them from. Okay. They'll usually supply
so
you.
So specifically designed for that hearing aid.
Correct. And there's about five different types. So if you find some, you'll have patients that'll have a drawer full of hearing aids. They bought three, four pair. Equipment that they have to maintain it is from an old. They're going, which one? So it can get a little confusing. This is an over-the-ear hearing aid with a full shell earpiece. And these two will separate. And this tube is hollow. So I have a little bulb syringe that will clean the hearing aid out with. A lot of our patients will hop in the shower with their hearing aids on. They get the hearing aid wet. They get moisture in their ear canal. That moisture gets up in the tube. So a lot of times if you can just separate it and blow out that tubing with a bulb syringe, that'll get the moisture out of the hearing aid, put the two back together again, and it'll work just fine. This is, we call it a cat's whisker. It's just a plastic tube, but it's real thin. And you can use that sometimes to clean the tubing out. If there's a little air vent there, you can literally slide that through, and that's just helpful in making sure that air vent stays clean and clear. When those vents get plugged up, that can actually change the sound quality of the hearing aid. So, patients who have chronic wax problems, patients who have drainage from the ear, if it plugs up the earpiece, that's going to affect the performance of the hearing aid. So one takeaway would be if you can help a patient who says they're not hearing well, or if you're dealing with a patient wearing hearing aids and you can tell that they're not hearing well, if they'll let you take a look at the hearing aids, just use something like a toothbrush and just clean it off. And if you'll clean the openings just like that, more often than not, you'll get rid of most of the loose debris. Change the battery out if it still isn't working well. And I think no matter what the style of hearing aid, just keep it simple if you do those. his battery in, or they'll put the battery in upside down and wonder why their hearing aid won't work. So you pull the battery out, or the tab off the battery, and if you just open the battery locker, typically that battery is only going to fit one way and it should close very smoothly. If you have the battery in upside down, you're going to find you're having to really force it. So flip the battery over, and typically you can figure out which way that should go. Okay. Another issue that we have, I'm not sure how relevant that's going to be for you, though, is, goes back to the type or the style of hearing aid that's recommended. A lot of patients nowadays are getting hearing aids that have a lot of technology in them. You may hear someone say, you know, they have a program button on their hearing aid, and that program button is designed so that we can give the patient a program for quiet environments versus, say, noisy environments. Probably the leading complaint I have from patients who are in assisted listening environments are when they go to the dining room to take meals. There's a lot of people in there. Typically those rooms have high ceilings. Sometimes they have tile floors. They're very reverberant. That's the biggest issue for them, is they can't hear the people at the table. And unfortunately, I'd love to say, yeah, we have hearing aids that'll take care of all that. Unfortunately, we really don't. Hearing aids nowadays are much, much better than what we were fitting just a few years ago. But when we talk about hearing loss with the elderly, what we find is that they have a lot of cognitive changes in their brain, how they process sound and background noise, that hearing aids do not address. And unfortunately, a lot of the hearing aid ads that you see in the newspaper don't really talk about that. It's all about trying to sell some kind of a hearing aid. So someone who's age 80, 85, 90 years of age, they're going to have a lot more difficulty in groups, background noise situations. And one of the ways we try to address that is by actually giving them multiple programs. There's a little, let's see if we can go to it. This is a volume control to adjust the volume up or down. This is a program button. So we may give the patient a program for quiet when they're back in their room, in their apartment, and then give them a second program that will help reduce the background noise by using directional microphones. And it does help. But I, just to be honest with you, that's probably the number one complaint for our patients in those environments is, works fine for me in my room. I can hear the TV. I can hear people one-to-one. But when I get down in the dining room, all bets are off. I can't even hear the people at my table very well. So typically we'll try to talk to them about different listening strategies. It might be, you know, the person at your table you have the most difficulty with, put them right next to you. The closer they are, the easier they are to hear. If you're sitting in a room and you're near the kitchen, put your back to the kitchen so that your directional microphones will kick in and cut down more of what's coming in from behind you. When you're dealing with someone that's 80 years old, 85 years old, that lasts for about 15 minutes. And when they get home, they've forgotten half of what you've told them. So, you know, you just have to understand that those are limitations that we have. Okay. Any other issues or concerns that you have? Do you all feel comfortable cleaning a hearing aid if you have? Okay. Mind if you are coming into a room with a patient. Number one is you want to get their attention. Sounds kind of straightforward, but you don't want to be walking up to a patient when you're off to the side or they're behind you and then just start talking. They didn't hear you. They're not tuned into you. So when you come into the room, what is your name?
McKenna.
Okay, McKenna, what you would want to do is you want to come into the room and get in front of the patient and say, hi, McKenna, how are you doing today? Get their attention. So number one, they're focused on you. You want to stay in front of them. You don't have to raise your voice or shout. In fact, raising your voice is the worst thing you can do. They may have the volume set at a comfortable level, And then when you start shouting because you're hearing impaired, you've just blown their doors away because now you're really loud to them. And with a lot of our senior citizens, they will tell you making the sound louder does not make it more clear. So our whole goal with hearing aids is to try to make the softer sounds louder, but to keep everything at a comfortable listening level where they can actually process that sound most efficiently. So number one, stay in front of them so that they can see your lips, they can see your face, get lip reading cues, so that they're alerted to focusing on you. Keep your voice at a comfortable level. Don't start talking and then turn around and go, well, let's do something over here and I want you to do this or that. As soon as you turn away, the voice drops. They can't get any facial cues, any lip reading cues. So you want to make sure you try to maintain fairly good eye contact. And then a lot of times it helps when you're done, summarize what you came in for, okay? We've checked your meds, McKenna. Are you okay on your meds? Do you have any questions about that? Summarizing what you're going to talk about helps them auditorily to go, okay, yeah, this, and this. So that way they're cued into you and they understand what you were there for so that when you leave, you can be pretty well assured that, you know, they've understood what you're doing. If there's anything in the background, if they have a television on, if they're in a room that has a dishwasher or fans or anything like that, if they're having problems understanding you, turn the TV down or turn it off. If there's any other background noise, if you can eliminate that or cut it down, that's going to make understanding and communication much, much easier. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other areas I can touch on for you?
Yeah, I got a couple. My in-laws were both hearing aid wearers, and they could always hear me, but they couldn't hear my wife. So does your voice frequency have anything to do with processing?
Absolutely. That's huge. Men are always complaining they can't hear their wives. You know? We have a separate diagnosis called selective attention. Let's see. What I want to do is I want to just show you an audiogram so I can speak to your issue, Jim. When we do a hearing test, what we're looking at are the different pitches or frequencies. So what we do is we will plot it. On this scale right here are the different frequencies. So very much like the notes on a piano keyboard, 250 hertz is a low pitch sound, 4,000, 8,000, these are high pitch sounds. And we plot how well they can hear those sounds on the decibel level, which is over here from 0 to 110. So let me just plot, for instance, what I would classify as just a typical mild to moderate hearing loss for somebody. And typically when we diagnose a hearing loss like this, it starts off normal or borderline normal in the low frequencies, and then as the frequencies go up in pitch, the hearing loss gets progressively worse. Okay, so basically normal down here, borderline normal here, and then we're looking at a mild to moderate hearing loss in the high frequencies. Now if we look at the different sounds in the environment, okay, water dripping out of a faucet, very low frequency, it's also very soft, only about 10 decibels. So something like that, you might walk right up to the sink and see the water dripping, but even with a borderline normal hearing, you're not going to hear the drip, drip, drip. A dog barking, low frequency, but quite loud, 60 to 70 decibels. So with a hearing loss like this, patient's going to hear a dog barking just as well as anyone with perfectly normal hearing. When we get up to the high frequencies, bird song, birds chirping in a tree, one of the first things patients with a high frequency loss will lose. You can watch the birds in the tree, you can be standing underneath it, you're not going to be hearing that chatter. So when we talk about how does that impact somebody's hearing for understanding communication, what we find is that this purple area here is what we call the speech banana. It's where all the vowels and consonants of speech fall. Well, the vowel sounds are typically lower frequency and they're pretty loud, 40 to 50 decibels. So A, E, I, O, U, these vowel sounds are fairly loud. So even somebody with a mild to moderate hearing loss hear those fine. What they're missing are these high frequency consonant sounds. And that's where you find people start saying, oh, my spouse mumbles to me. Or I can hear them talking, but I don't hear them clearly. They're mumbling. That's where most of our patients actually need the help. That's where most of the hearing aids are designed to boost those softer, high-frequency sounds. But people go for years with this type of a hearing loss, and what they'll do is turn the TV up higher. They'll ask people to repeat things. But they won't think in terms of I have a hearing loss, because we tend to think of a hearing loss as you're deaf. Either you heard it or you didn't. And most of these hearing losses come on very, very mild at first, and then they get progressively worse where they affect more and more of the speech range. We're also finding that there's a strong relationship between Alzheimer's and dementia and hearing loss. Not that having a hearing loss is going to give you dementia or Alzheimer's, but what we're finding is that it will exacerbate those conditions and actually cause those conditions to get worse much, much earlier. So we see a lot of when they develop a hearing loss, men more so than women, they tend to detach. So you can probably remember a grandparent who had a hearing loss and they kind of sat on their own. They didn't participate in what was going on in family situations. Well, if they're prone to dementia or Alzheimer's, what it does is it just kind of walls them off even quicker at an earlier age where they basically are living in a world all their own. So one of our issues is to try to get hearing loss diagnosed quicker, earlier, and keep people doing the activities that they enjoy. So that's kind of a new development over the last 4 or 5 years.
So gender really has less to do with, I guess, people's ability with the hearing aid to process the information. It's more the sound and how the sounds come out of your mouth, it sounds like.
That's true, but there is a gender situation. My own practice, what I find is that women are more relational. So the joke is, if a woman has a hearing loss, she's going to get a hearing aid because she doesn't want to miss that relationship, or she doesn't want to miss all that gossip. Men, on the other hand, are a lot more into the denial. I don't have a problem if I have to turn the TV up. It's driving your wife out of the house. I don't turn the TV up. It's no big deal. I don't mind if I have to keep asking my spouse to repeat things over and over. We have problems when we go to a restaurant, can't hear very well. So a man might say, well, we're not going to go out to eat. It's no fun. My wife can stay home and cook for me. There's different ways of handling a hearing loss. And what we find a lot of times is men more than women tend to detach and stop doing the kinds of activities that they like to do, where women, because I think they are more relational, it's like, well, what do I have to do to help my hearing, because I'm going to do the things that I like to do. So women tend to be a little bit more progressive about health issues in general than men, and we all know that. Men don't go to the doctor until they're dying, whereas women are a little bit more aggressive about making sure they take care of that. And that impacts if you have a hearing loss. So we have more issues with men being dragged to the office to have their hearing tested, not because they want to go, but because their wife said, I'm going to hit you over the head with a frying pan if you don't do something about your hearing loss. And that affects their motivation for trying hearing aids. I mean, they didn't want to be there in the first place. Now we're going to tell them you're going to spend several thousand dollars on hearing aids. So,
what about race?
Mm-hmm. We're not seeing a lot of differences race-wise unless we start talking about middle ear problems. With middle ear issues, we see more problems with Native Americans with middle ear problems, Eskimo population, things of that nature. One of the things we do find that's interesting with race, which talks about our industrial society, if you go up north to a lot of the Eskimo communities, somebody who's age 70 or 80 years of age, they have no hearing loss. So the idea that there's age related just because of you getting older, there are some cultures where they're not around noise at all. They don't have very much, if any, inner ear hearing loss. We are in an industrial society where we are bombarded by noise. So men, women working on farms, around farm machinery and industry, around heavy machinery, young people wearing their MP3s. We know now they're going to be in at an earlier age because of that. You know, people who drive around with their stereo in their trunk and you can see the windows vibrate, they're going to be in to see us sooner, you know, that kind of thing. So we are seeing differences there. So if you don't want to develop any hearing loss, go on up to the Arctic and you might be better off there. I don't know. Yeah.
Tinnitus. If somebody suffers with that, number one, is there a remedy? And then number two, if you have a hearing aid, is that accounted for, that ringing in your ear?
That's a good question. The majority of people who have ringing, the term we use is tinnitus or tinnitus. It's Latin for ringing in the ears. Tinnitus may be ringing. Some people say it's a roaring or a rushing sound. It can have a lot of different sounds to people. Typically, it's due to the inner ear nerves being damaged. And we think because there are no pain receptors in the cochlea, that's the hearing nerve's way of saying, I've been damaged. So when you go to a concert and your ears ring afterwards because you sat too close to the speakers or the group was just too loud, when that happens, you're going through what we call temporary threshold shift. If we checked your hearing right after the concert, your hearing would probably be down 10 or 15 decibels. And then after a period of 2 or 3 days, that ringing, that cotton feeling in your ears goes away. Most of that hearing will come back. So it's a temporary threshold shift. But you actually are losing a little bit of your hearing. So someone who goes to those concerts frequently over a period of time, they're doing a lot of damage. Shooting guns is notorious for causing ringing in the ears. And we have patients who shot a gun once out in the desert and they have ringing and they've had it for 20 years.
Wow.
So yeah, that's unfortunate. Now, the tinnitus, what we find because of the inner ear nerve damage, about 70% of patients who have hearing loss with tinnitus will get relief from the tinnitus if they're fit with appropriate hearing aids. And we're not sure of the mechanism other than the amplification tends to remove the tinnitus. If you take your hearing aids off, a lot of times after a few hours or a few days, the tinnitus comes back. So the hearing aid has more of a masking effect that the tinnitus is gone while you're wearing it. So for patients who come in who have ringing in the ears, the number one therapy for that typically is get a hearing test and be fit with appropriate hearing aids. Not everybody gets the same benefit, so that depends. Patients who have tinnitus with no hearing loss, typically we're going to refer out for an otologic workup, because then we're looking at more at a tumor or some space-occupying lesion higher up in the auditory nerve. So, sign that you need to have your hearing aid. And depending on those test results, you may need to have further x-rays, MRI, things like that.
Would that be surgically repairable then at that point, if there's like a little tumor or something like that?
Yeah, the tumor can typically be removed, but it depends on where it is. A lot of times, if it's on the vestibular or the acoustic nerve, it's a watch and wait. One of my providers, her mother has an acoustic neuroma. She's had it for 15 years, and they're just watching it. It's causing minimal hearing loss, a little bit of tinnitus, but it's not growing, so they didn't do anything. On the situation. Okay.
I have one more question.
Good questions.
You had talked about there's two times, it appears to me, that somebody with a hearing aid is going to maybe have a decreased, you know, level of hearing. One of those was when they walked in the shower and they didn't take their hearing aids out. They could get it filled with water. that type of thing. The other is wax, and that's something that's going to happen. Is there something in assisted living that should be done that's preventative to keep the ear canal clean of wax? And
yeah, you can. If you have access to an otoscope and take a look in their ear, if you're seeing a significant wax buildup, there's no reason why nursing can't irrigate the ear. Typically, that's about the only way in that facility that I think wax would be cleaned. In our office, we have suction, we have irrigation, and we have curette, forceps for removing foreign bodies. So we have more of the appropriate equipment. But in an assisted living situation, I don't see why you can't use irrigation. I've seen some doctor's offices use a water pick and just get a little bowl or cup under the ear. Have them sitting upright, and you can just irrigate the ear with the water pick. But you have to do probably a good pint. You can't just shoot a little bit of water in there and get it all out, because usually the wax is sticky and fairly solid. So you actually have to loosen it up before you do anything. Well, that's kind of another approach. If it's what we call impacted wax, washing it out's not going to do a whole lot. You'll spend 2-3 hours there. So yeah, you'll put 2 or 3 drops of a ceruminolytic in, soften the wax, and then come back 24-48 hours later, try to irrigate it. As long as you have an otoscope and you can see if you're making progress, you can do that.
Is that something that's done in assisted living?
We have, but you have to have the orders for the drops.
Okay.
And then obviously, if you have nursing staff, a lot of times it's up to the nurse to do that. Rarely do we allow the caregivers to do the actual flushing.
Yeah, I would agree. And that's a real problem for patients who are laying down for long periods of time and who wear hearing aids, because just the day-to-day putting that earpiece in, you're tending to shove that wax back. And if they're laying down for long periods, we find for whatever reason the wax glands tend to kick up. The ears don't drain naturally. The wax comes out when you're walking around, when you shower. It comes out in little pieces you hardly ever even see. But when you're laying down and you're wearing hearing aids, it just tends to accumulate, and we have a lot more problems with it.
What about this new, have you seen the commercials for this earwax vacuum thing?
It does not work.
I've
had 3 or 4 patients bring them in. It doesn't even go down in the ear canal far enough to do anything.
Yeah.
I think they're relying on the no return or the return policy.
Yeah.
You know, send it back, we'll give you your money back. I think people buy it and go, ah, it didn't work, and they just put it aside. So that's unfortunate. A lot of patients bought into that.
Yeah, I bet.
I agree. There's a lot of that along the lines of internet sales of hearing aids, too. United Healthcare, a major healthcare agency, is now promoting as a hearing aid benefit to some of their patients that they'll give you like $200 or $300 benefit per ear, and you can order certain hearing aids off the internet. That is a recipe for failure. I mean, when I look at what we go through to fit a hearing aid and counsel the patient and show them how to take it on and off, there's just no way you're going to order anything on the internet and figure out for yourself based on a booklet, how do I put this on and how do I wear it? So unfortunately, there's a lot of that going on. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I thought you would have some questions in the back there.
I got them out at the beginning.
Okay.
My cohorts here have
good
ones that were mine.
Good.
I have just noticed as I have gotten older that it seems that the wax production has quadrupled in time, and I don't know, I'm assuming that that's normal.
Yeah, we do see that a lot. We wonder sometimes with some people if it's tied to diet. Certain items in your diet can cause your wax glands to produce more, but it's not consistent from one person to the next. We do find patients tend to, as they get older, want to clean their ears with Q-tips. That's a no-no, because what you do is you get some out, but you actually tamp more of it in, and it tends to promote more wax issues. So what we tell our patients is don't put anything in your ear smaller than your elbow, you know, which goes against the grain when we recommend hearing aids, because now we're saying, okay, don't stick a Q-tip in your ear, just stick this hearing aid in your ear. So that tends to cause problems all on its own.
The ear candles work for you.
your candles do not work.
What? So what's all that stuff inside?
That is the impurities in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
The next time, if somebody candles your ear, take a look at the paper, the cone they're going to put in your ear. Open the cone out. It's almost like a papyrus. It's a heavy paper with a lot of cottony. Yeah, I know, that's what they tell you.
That's what they want you to believe.
Yep.
I was like, that came out of my ear?
Yeah, that's actually the impurities in the paper. I have patients that have had their ears candled, and 2 days later they're in my office, and we show them their ear. It's just as full of wax.
Wow.
So, yeah. Does not work. The other issue is we're afraid you might set your hair on fire because you're supposed to light it and then let it burn about half to three quarters of the way down and then extinguish it. Well, there'll be some idiot that'll set their hair on fire. So
that would be my luck.
Yeah. Good question, though. All right. Any other questions? Well, I thank you all for inviting me, and good luck to you. You're welcome. If I can provide any support information or that to you, you know, please feel free to let me know. I'll be happy to do that. I do.
Doctor, would it be possible for us to have or get some worn out devices that we could use for show and tell?
I gave you some. If you need more of them, you know, absolutely, I'd be happy to.
Yeah, we have them in the cabinet.
Okay.
And, yeah, and if you do accumulate more, I mean, then you'd be willing to give us a holler. I mean, we'll always take them.
You bet.
Because sometimes things have a way to walk away, and as much as we try to. Yeah.
Well, and to me, the thing is, don't be intimidated by hearing aids, because a lot of aides and nurses are like, you know, that's expensive, and oh, I don't want to touch it, and a lot of times that the patient, if you can tell the patient's not hearing you well, you know, take the hearing aids off and just take a look at it. Sometimes it's as simple as a dead battery or just a little end of it. Communication a lot better for the both of you.
We teach our students to take blood pressures, and sometimes they have trouble hearing it. Do you know what kind of sound the blood pressure is?
It's a low frequency sound. Yeah, I think it's around 400 hertz. Yeah, patients who have a hearing loss that have to use a stethoscope, there are amplified stethoscopes, and we now have hearing aids that go down in the ear where we can make an earpiece that goes on their regular stethoscope so that they can hear the body sounds. Yeah. I have a couple of patients who are in med school. You have to pass a test being able to get an accurate heart sound, you know, blood pressure and that, so that was important.
And would that be a less cost option than getting an amplified? I mean, we have an amplified stethoscope here, but, you know, they tend to be a little bit bulkier, and some of them are pretty expensive. They can go up to $300, $400. So would the hearing aid approach be a less costly approach?
No, the hearing aid would probably be a more costly approach, but if they have a hearing loss that's making them need a amplified stone, start with the hearing aid, because we can address their issues other than stethoscope use so that they can get the lecture material and focus on patient interaction much, much better, and then deal with the stethoscope issue with earplugs or some specialty item.
It's my impression that there does come a time with hearing loss that it's not how loud you can crank up the hearing aid anymore. It's
absolutely.
A sound discrimination.
Yep.
In the brain.
Yep. I won't say nothing, but you're going to reach a point of no return on investment if you're basically just going to get a stronger and a stronger hearing aid. Yeah, we try to tell patients that when you have, as you get older, we all develop processing problems. Our auditory memory is not as good, even with normal hearing. Our auditory processing is not as good. We don't focus as well in a group. You know, so all you young people, you can probably go into a group, a room full of people with different conversations, and you can stand there and listen to this group over here and then shut it out, listen to this group without moving. As we get older, you're going to lose that ability. So the idea, unfortunately, with a lot of the hearing aid ads is if you're not hearing your best unless you have this super duper ABC hearing aid. That ABC hearing aid may have great technology in it, but as you're saying in the back there, you're going to reach a point where we can make sounds louder, we have some sophisticated noise reduction techniques, but we shouldn't be telling you you're going to hear good in a group or a crowd or under adverse listening conditions. And that's a real problem because the hearing aid industry, just like the pharmaceutical companies are hawking all of their meds on TV, thinking you're going to go back to your doctor and you're going to ask for this med, the hearing aid manufacturers are subsidizing a lot of these hearing aid ads that you see in the newspaper. And what they're doing is they're telling you all the good things that their hearing aids do, but they don't take into account, did you get an accurate hearing test? Are you being given appropriate expectations? Is the person who's fitting you programming the device correctly? And are they giving you appropriate expectations? So you really just get caught up in that advertising hype, and that's not necessarily a good thing.
Mr. Schraber, you go into assisted living homes and just do end services, or do you go in and work with the residents and those type of things?
We do both. Typically, what we'll do a lot of times is we'll go in service the nurses and the aides there as to much of like what we've done here, but we'll also go in and do a hearing aid clinic where we'll set up in a room and patients can come down with their hearing aids and we'll clean and check them for them so they don't have to leave the facility for a doctor's appointment. Yep, so we're available for that. All right, so I'll leave my business cards here, and I have some extra handouts if there are. And if you want, I'll leave you toothbrushes. I'll leave you some toothbrushes too, okay?